I believe that if you understand the buying process, costs can be minimized and quality can be monitored.
You know, don't quit your job because you still have to have a job through closing.
Could a lender pull out and say, you know what, the house is not in great condition?
Don't give up your American dream because you're scared.
Most of us depend on realtors to take care of our transactions when purchasing a home. It is a prudent decision to rely on a licensed professional. But I believe that if you understand the buying process, costs can be minimized and quality can be monitored. Next to me is Jenny Pham, CEO and broker of JP Real Estate and Mortgage Inc. She has 12 years of experience in the San Diego market. And today, I've asked Jenny to come and share with us what to expect after your home is accepted.
Thank you so much, Teresa, for inviting me over for this session today. It's been a long time.
It has been a long time.
So for the purpose of today's video, we're going to cover what you need to know from when your offer is accepted.
Yes, absolutely. I think a lot of time people rely on their realtors, as they should, because as a professional, I think it's super, super important that you have someone that are knowledgeable, that are experienced getting involved in these transactions. However, when you put out that much money, it's also crucial to me that you should know the transaction so that you can be in control.
Correct. Yeah, home buying is a big step. It's a lot of money involved. And so there are a lot of things that, you know, that happen after we get our offer accepted. So today we're going to go over that. So once your offer is accepted, what we do is we open escrow. So escrow is a process that typically take about 30 days. It could be shorter or longer, but typically 30 days. Once we open escrow, then we're going to start doing multiple things at the same time. We're going to send in our loan application, lock in the interest rate, get the appraisal going on. At the same time, do the inspection. So inspection could be the physical inspection to find out the condition of the house and the review the disclosures sent by the seller, review the title report sent by the title company. So all of those happen at the same time. And then when the loan conclude, when all the inspections are done, or the post offer negotiations are done, then we go to closing and key exchange and the happy stuff.
The happy stuff. Okay. So take me back a little bit. I kind of want to go step by step with this. Once the offer is accepted, escrow is opened. The process of escrow opening, and you had mentioned that then you send in the loan application. Isn't it more prudent that they actually do a pre-approval first and then getting the loan started already versus waiting until after? Because there's going to be a time crunch, isn't there?
Right. So usually the shopping for a lender and the pre-approval should take place before you even go shopping for a house. Mm-hmm. So when you start going shopping for a house, you should already know how much, you know, you can purchase, you know, what you need to do for your loan to get approved at a later stage. But that part is called pre-approved. You don't actually do the real loan application until you get a house.
Really? So that's kind of nerve-wracking to me, because if I get a pre-approval, I would think that I'm approved. And if I put an offer in and there's a chance that I may not get the house or my loan going through, that's kind of scary, isn't it?
Possibly. So you do have the protection for the loan when you're in escrow. In case your loan doesn't get approved, you still have a way out. But for the pre-approval process, you want to go with an experienced person who know what they do and who are experienced in the loan type that you are doing. And they should look at your income, your credit, your down payment, everything thoroughly, mm-hmm. and prep you for the later stage. Mm-hmm. But yes, you may run the risk of not getting your loan approved. So if you're going to be buying a house, you know, don't quit your job because you still have to have a job through closing. Mm-hmm. So most people think that, hey, we get a loan pre-approved and that's it, right?
Right.
But no, if you don't have a job or if you quit your job or something like that, get laid off, then you still don't get a loan.
Ah, so some of those factors is actually if there are changes between the time that you get pre-approved versus the time that you actually found a house and move forward.
Correct. So if you get pre-approved, everything have to stay the same. So no changing, no switching, nothing. Everything has to stay the same or else you run the risk.
Have you ever seen outside of, I can understand the job, especially in this market or this condition that we are in right now, but have you also seen people's credit change over that period of time? Is that even, does it happen?
It did happen a few times. You know, we have a lot of clients that co-signed for other people. And so when we take the pre-approval, everything was good, but during that time, the person that they co-signed for whatever stuff for didn't make the payment, you know, things like that. So it could affect their credit. So just make sure that you watch everything on your credit profile, not just the debt that you're responsible for, but also the debts that you cover for other people.
And then you had mentioned a few other things. And you say that a lot of these are happening simultaneously at the same time.
The inspections.
Okay, talk to me a little bit about that. When you say the inspection, is that something that the lender require? Is that something that the buyer, seller, the realtor, how does it all work?
Okay, so the lenders don't require the inspection. You're not required to do inspection, but real estate brokers always advise, should always advise clients to do the inspection, because when you go see a house and you make an offer, all you see is, oh, the house had like nice stairs, you know, nice kitchen, cabinets, whatever it is. You don't actually see the plumbing, the roof or foundation or anything like that, right? So the inspection help you understand the condition of the property.
Okay.
And that's for your benefits. So you pay for it. I mean, the buyers are paying for it and they have the right to do the inspection.
Okay.
But if they don't, I mean, some savvy buyers don't want to do the inspection and that's fine, but most buyers should do.
Okay. So then could, if let's say you are pre-approved for the loan and then now I guess the loan application go forward and let's say the lender is okay with that next step as well, could an inspection discovering something critical to the house then affect the loan process altogether? Could a lender pull out and say, you know what, the house is not in great condition, it's not what, you know, was originally supposed to be, and then they would end up not being able to be pre-approved for the home?
So two thoughts going into this. The lender will send an appraiser out. Most house would require an appraisal. So the bank is going to send the appraiser out to verify the condition of the property and to give an opinion on the value, right? So if they go out and they see like a hanging piece of wood or something that can cause hazards, then they're going to put on their report and the banks mostly will require that to be fixed. But they only pay attention to health and safety issues.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but if the house is ugly or if the foundation or if, you know, things like
or if it has termites, would any of those affect?
Termites could be if it's really bad termites that the appraiser sees and put on their reports.
Okay.
Yeah.
So would that make them lose a loan or is it just a condition then that you have to do something about?
Right. So all VA loans require termite clearance. The other loans don't require termite clearance as long as it's not affecting the conditions of the house. So as I mentioned to you, if like pieces of wood are chipping and things like that, the lenders may require fixing. But most houses have termites. And so if you do an inspection and there are termites, it's not going to be required by the lender unless they know about it. So if you put on the contract that, you know, we require termite clearance prior to closing, the lender may require for that to be fixed. Or if you or the real estate professional or the loan officer accidentally send in the inspection report, which you should not do, to the lender, then the lender will require because they already see it, so they cannot unsee it.
So it's basically don't offer information unless it's asked.
Correct.
And if you accidentally you accidentally offer it, then you may put yourself in a kind of a questionable situation.
Right. Okay. So when you request for a repair, right? Mm-hmm. So this is what we do all the time. We have the clients do the inspection, you know, hire a professional to do the inspection. And there are stuff, you know, in the house and, you know, that costs some money to fix. We help them negotiate with the seller for these items to be fixed or give the money. Mm-hmm. So we have a set of documents that, you know, for the real estate files that, yeah, seller is willing to give money for this and that. Mm-hmm. Right? But then we have another document for the lender to see that, hey, the seller is crediting the buyer $5,000, $10,000, mm-hmm. whatever it is. But we're not going to mention what it is. We just say that the seller is crediting the buyer $5,000 or $10,000 for closing costs.
Okay.
Without mentioning.
And the underwriting process doesn't require that you have to disclose that.
No.
Okay. All right.
No.
So then you mentioned two things that can be a little bit confusing to the consumer, I think. You said an appraiser and then also an inspection. And to some people, that's actually the same thing. It's two different things.
It's two different things. So the appraisal, if required, and mostly is required on a loan, it's for the lender benefit, mm-hmm. because the lender is lending the buyer the money. So they want to make sure that the property is actually worth that much.
And they have certain specific underwriting requirement. Therefore, the other stuff that is in the inspection report may not matter. And that's why they wouldn't look at it unless you give them reasons to look at it.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the appraisal is more for the value mm-hmm. side of it. That, yeah, hey, I think this house is worth that much. And there's nothing wrong with it. There's nothing that need to be fixed, right? Mm-hmm. Just on the surface, they come, they take 5 minutes picture. The inspection is for consumer purposes, for you to find out the condition of the house. So an inspection can take about 1.5 hour to 3-4 hours, depending on how large the home is. Mm-hmm. And that cover a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. So they go under the crawl space, they climb up the roof, they check plumbing, pretty much everything. Mm-hmm. To make sure that you understand the conditions of the house.
Okay.
And that is optional. So you don't have to do it, but you should do it.
All right. And then after that, and everything goes well, then we move into the closing phase.
Right. So together with the physical inspections, mm-hmm. there are inspections for the paperwork per se.
Oh,
so
okay.
So the sellers would disclose everything that they know mm-hmm. about the house. And one of the questions in California is that, you know, in the last 3 years, if there's any death in the house.
Oh,
that's a
yes.
question that I get asked all the time.
Yes. And there are some people who would not be very comfortable with that. There is also the superstition as well. Now, if there are a disclosure of death that actually occurred in the house, is it something then the buyer can pull out and decide that it's not, that they don't want to move forward with the purchase?
So during the home buying process, the buyers are typically protected by three different things. The first thing would be the inspection, and that is for everything. The physical inspection, the review, the disclosures, the title report, anything and everything. Their okay. mom may not like the house, their cousin may not like it, they can back out during the inspection period.
Which is about how long?
On the contract, it says 17 days.
From the date that the...
Open escrow,
okay.
Yeah, but typically it's shorter than that because, you know, the seller don't want to wait 17 days for the buyer just to back out. Mm-hmm. There is the protection for the appraisal. So if the appraisal doesn't come in value, then, you know, they can back out at the same time or cancel. And the third protection is for the loan. Remember the loan process?
Right.
Yes. So if
they don't qualify for the loan, the buyer does have some recourse. It's not like they would lose their deposit or anything then.
Correct.
Oh, that's awesome.
If it's done correctly. Mm-hmm. So there are certain protections, and then so the real estate professional can guide the buyers through that. Mm-hmm. So I've heard a lot of concerns from new buyers that, you know, hey, this person say that if we get into escrow and we cancel, we lose the deposit. No, mm-hmm. you know, you still have certain protections. So if you do within your rights, mm-hmm. you don't lose your deposit.
So Jenny, let's recap. take it from beginning. I meant beginning after the offer is accepted until the time that the buyer can move into their new home.
Okay. So once the offer is accepted, you open escrow, you place a deposit into escrow, and we start the inspection, read everything, you know, review everything with the real estate professional and your inspector, start the loan process, lock the rate, you know, and we're done. When the loan conclude, that's when we're done. Okay. And so I just want to give out this message to all potential buyers out there. I know home buying can be a little bit scary, or, you know, it may look confusing, but, you know, don't be afraid, because you have all the protections that you need. So you can cancel without, you know, losing your deposit or anything like that. So don't be afraid, because, you know, that is
why you go to a professional.
Exactly.
And they will walk you through that.
Right.
But like I say, you still should know what you're doing as well, right?
Don't give up your American dream because you're scared.
That's right. That's right.
Find someone that can help you obtain the American dream.
Mm-hmm. So there you go. Buying a home is exciting, and it can be very stressful at the same time. Knowing what you expect and working with an experienced professional definitely can make the transition smooth and painless. If you find this program useful, please make sure to give us a thumbs up and subscribe, and I will bring you more You Perfected concepts.